Let God be God. This is a call to intimacy with God. As a disciple, we are first of all called to an intimate relationship with God. It is that place that we are able to hear Him and fully trust and surrender everything to Him. You know, it's something like a child dancing with the father. She gently places her foot on his feet. And together, you know, it's like a rhythm and a dance that's being led by the Father. She gazes at Him, mesmerized by His love. And in this place, she's fully trusting Him. And even if she should stumble, He picks her up again and leads her one more time. It is intimacy with the Father, being led by Him. It is His desire to lead us every step of the way, and for us to place our hands in His hands and to be led by our God. He knows what is the best for us. There are times when the storms of life will hit us, and it can be really frightening. It can be a place of fear, deep fear. Things may come in one after another. And it is in that place where we are able to make Scripture come alive, because we have that communion with the Father. For it says in Isaiah 41, 13 to 14, "For I am the Lord your God, who takes hold of your right hand and says to you, do not fear, I will help you. Do not be afraid, you worm Jacob. Little Israel, do not fear, for I myself will help you, declares the Lord, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel." Don't we sometimes feel like a worm? We feel so little compared to the problems, the humongous problems that we face. But yet the Lord says, "I am your God." He is our Father. And in verse 15 it says, "I will make you into a threshing sledge, new and sharp with many teeth. You will thresh the mountains and crush them and reduce the hills to chaff." You know, in this verse He reminds us that not only is He intimately close to us, but in the place of waiting, in the place of trust, He's actually building inside of us strength to fight the battles, strength to overcome. And out of that, we are able to set others free. This closeness draws us to that place of hunger where we desire more and more of His presence. We want to know Him more in His Word. You know, that place of intimacy is actually a place where we are being filled by Him, and therefore ministry is an outflow. Ministry will flow out of that place of intimacy. In Zephaniah 3:17, it says, "The Lord your God is with you, the mighty warrior who says, He will take great delight in you. In His love, He will no longer rebuke you, but will rejoice over you with singing." Sometimes in my quiet times in worship, I feel like I'm truly dancing with Father God. And I know that this is this place that He wants us to come intimately in this relationship with Him. So as His disciples, let us all come to that place where we will truly dance with our Father.
I used to be a beggar, down on calloused knees, till
got an invitation into the courts of a king. I'm moving on, keep moving. I'm moving on. You gave me my freedom, now I'm free indeed. I'm marching on.
As a disciple of Jesus Christ, we have now been given a new identity in Christ. The book of Ephesians chapter 1 says we are chosen, we are adopted to sonship as His sons and daughters. We have a God-given identity that changes our very DNA. In truly following Jesus, we develop a discipleship DNA. And this is not a superficial change, but it is deeply rooted in our relationship with Jesus Christ. We no longer live for ourselves. This new purpose is built by our seeking first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. This new purpose is also for us to know Christ and to make him known, to love him and to love one another. The Bible urges us to run, but not just to run. The Bible gives us a specific way in which we are to run. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1 and 2 says, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. Let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith." Life is not a short race. It is the race of life. Sometimes we get discouraged, we stumble, we fall, and we struggle. However, the beauty of the Word of God is that we are called in this new identity to be grafted into the family of God. The Bible says this is the body of Christ. We do not run alone. This togetherness is a very powerful truth. It helps us to stay on track. It encourages us on our journey as disciples. We care for one another. We love one another. We run together. We are a community of believers that are better together. And when we do that, John chapter 13 verse 35 says, "By this everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another." We have a new identity, a new purpose and destiny. We are running together as disciples, as a community. Would you follow after Jesus? Would you lay your life to be aligned to Christ in the days ahead? Let us run the race together with Jesus as the person we look towards in this journey.
Question mark. This is for the outcast soul, lost control, no one knows. Sing it for the can't go back. Sing it for the broken past. Sing it for the just found out life is now upside down.
If you're looking for hope tonight, raise your hand. If you're feeling alone and don't
loved in vain, overcame, it's not too late.
Together. tonight. If you're in the fight of your life, we're gonna make it hand in hand.
I will be by your side. It's love in the air tonight. I'll help you see the light. We're gonna make it together.
Together with our differences, together we are bolder, braver, stronger.
Second Corinthians chapter 5 verse 17 tells us, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he or she is a new creation. All things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. When we make that decision to follow Jesus, we begin our new life as newborn babes. And as in the natural, we need to grow as part of the family of God, which is the church.
I can remember even buying so many Lego sets for my children, and I always can remember, you know, the excited faces of my children when they get this new set and they pour out the many pieces and they want to get at it. And very quickly, you would see that they are struggling and they can't find the right pieces. And lo and behold, mommy and daddy would just come and said, we could do it together. So as a Christian, I have been very blessed that when I first accepted the Lord, I was truly blessed to have a group of more mature Christians who came alongside me, who then, you know, week after week taught me how to read the Bible, how to pray. And eventually, they even taught me how to go out and share my faith. And I really thank God that those times where these older Christians came to disciple me, it has helped me to build a strong foundation so that I can be a disciple of Jesus Christ. In Hebrews chapter 4 verse 12, it says, the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates to dividing the soul and spirit, joint and marrow. It judges the thoughts and the attitudes of the heart. Being able to chew on the Word of God will allow us to take root in the promises of God. When we do that, the Word of God becomes an anchor and a security for our faith in the Lord. I am sure that all of you would agree with me that the expectation for all living things is for them to continue growing. So what happens when these living things stop growing? It means it's a sign that they're starting to die. So as Christians, we need to have this mindset of growth, one where we would dig deep into the Word of God so that we would allow ourselves to be able to understand more of the truth of Christ. That even as I mature in my spiritual life, I was able to attempt and overcome more difficult challenges in life. Like a child, even as we grow up, you know, we were able to attempt, you know, more difficult Lego sets.
And even as we grow in Christ, we will be able to bear fruits. We become blessings to the people around us. We become the disciples that Jesus wants us to be, reflecting His glory and His image. The challenge for us today is that we must desire to grow and to seek after God's things so that continually we will become more and more like Jesus, so that whatever He calls us to do, we will be ready to do it as disciples of Jesus Christ.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I made. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb, yeah, till I made. You called my name and I
you. Welcome to FGA Online Church Service. Do remember that today is Communion Sunday, so I would like to encourage you to prepare your emblem so that we can partake of the communion together afterwards. Now, no matter what you're going through, I know it's very challenging times. It's time of uncertainty. It's time of difficulties. But I want to assure you that God is still in control. Jesus Christ, our Lord God and Savior, the maker of heaven and earth, He is still the King of kings and the Lord of lords. I want to read to you Psalms 46, that our hearts can be assured that He is our refuge, He is our help, even right at this very moment. Psalms 46. God is our strong refuge. He's truly our helper in times of trouble. For this reason, we do not fear when the earth shakes and the mountains tumble into the depths of the sea, when its waves crash and foam, and the mountains shake before the surging sea. The river channels bring joy to the city of God, the special holy dwelling place of the Most High. God lives within it. It cannot be moved. God rescues it at the break of dawn. Nations are in uproar. Kingdoms are overthrown. God gives a shout. The earth dissolves. The Lord of heaven's armies is on our side. The God of Jacob is our stronghold. Come, witness the exploits of the Lord, who brings devastation to the earth. He brings an end to wars throughout the earth. He shatters the bow and breaks the spear. He burns the shields with fire. Verse 10, He says, stop your striving and recognize that I am God. I will be exalted over the nations. I will be exalted over the earth. The Lord of heaven, heaven's armies is on our side. The Lord of heaven's armies is on our side. The God of Jacob is our stronghold. Let's pray. Heavenly gracious Father, we come to you acknowledging that you are above all things and you are the God who is in control. We say we will not be anxious, we will not fear, but in every situation, we will look to you. We will come to you in prayer and thanksgiving and make our requests known to you. Surely you will hear our prayer. Surely you will help us and deliver us. We declare you are our refuge. You are our stronghold. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's just sing. Come let us worship our King. Come let us bow at His feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how His love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. Oh, heroes of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awaken alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great things. Hey! You've been faithful through every storm. You've been faithful forevermore. You will not give in. And I know you will do it again. For your promise in yes and amen, you will do great things. God, you do great things. The grave,
chain, O God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awaken the light. O Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. O God, you have done great unshakable, hallelujah. You have done great things, you've done great things. Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things, you've done great things. We sing hallelujah. Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things. You've done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Done great things. We dance in your freedom, awaken the light. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great things. We hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awaken the light. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh God, you have done great things.
We sing hallelujah.
Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah. You've done great things, you've done great things. Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, you have done great things, you've done great things. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? 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 Who can stop the
hearts declare His praise. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before Him.
God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. Oh. Who comes to sing? He's here to set the captives free. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb. Was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. Stop the Lord Almighty. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? 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 Who can stop the Lord? Our God is a Lion. The Lion of Judah, He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chain. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before me. Our God is a Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. Blood breaks the chains. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. We fall down. We lay our crowns at the feet of Jesus. The greatness of mercy and love at the feet of Jesus. We cry.
again. We fall down, we lay our crowns at the feet of Jesus. The greatness song, mercy and love at the feet of Jesus. We cry, let's just begin to fall in front of Jesus. Even as we sing this song again, let's just surrender ourselves to God. Even this morning, let's just make it as our prayer that we want to fall in front of Jesus and declare that He is our holy God. He is our holy God. We fall down, we lay our crowns at the feet of Jesus. Greatness of mercy and love at the feet of Jesus, we cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry.
Praise the Lord for a time of just being able to worship Him. And right now, we want to prepare our hearts for communion. As we approach the Lord's table, let's come with a heart of humility. Let's come searching our own hearts that we will be taking the Lord's supper together in a worthy manner. We are taking communion because of what Jesus has done for us. We are taking communion because we are a body of Christ. And it is in John chapter 6 verse 53 that Jesus said, unless we eat of His flesh and drink of His blood, we have no part in Him. So this morning, as we come together as a family of God to take Holy Communion together, we want to just right now come with an attitude of searching our hearts, that we come in a worthy manner. We come because Jesus make it possible for us to come. We can partake communion because of His love. Lord, as we approach Your table, we thank You for coming to save us from our sins. You did not see us as unworthy, But because of your love, you made it a way that we can be cleansed and we can abide in you and you in us. So this morning, we want to remember all that you have done for us. And we come, Lord, remembering not only what you have done, but we remember that one day you will come back again. Lord, help us, we pray, as we await your return. In Jesus' name. Matthew 26, verse 26, it says, as they were eating, Jesus took some bread and blessed it. Then he broke it in pieces and gave it to the disciples, saying, take this and eat it, for this is my body. Let us right now give thanks to God for giving his body to us, that even as we partake of his body, we want to claim his promise that says, by his stripe, we are all healed of every sicknesses and diseases. Shall we partake of the bread together? And then Jesus took a cup of wine and gave thanks to God for it. He gave it to them and said, each of you drink for it. For this is my blood, which confirms the covenant between God and his people. It is poured out as a sacrifice to forgive the sins of many. Even as we partake of the cup that represents the blood of Jesus, today we stand not condemned, but cleansed by the blood of Jesus. And I want to say this, there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Let's partake of the cup together, giving thanks for the forgiveness of sins that he has given to us. Let us just take one moment to just give thanks to God for all that he has done for you and me. That indeed, Jesus is our Savior, our hope of glory, our King of Kings, our Master, our Lord. And this morning, if you have a need and you feel that you need help, I want to assure you that Jesus, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, is Emmanuel. He is God who is with you and who is with us. But if you do need prayer, I want to pray for you right now. That God will help you to know that you are not alone. Lord, whatever situation anyone right now is going through, who is crying out to you, you are a God who answers our prayer. So Lord, according to your great and mighty power and your perfect will, I pray that you will hear the cry of your people and you will deliver and you will answer. If there's anyone sick, I pray, Lord, you will touch and heal. If there's anyone who is lonely, I pray, Holy Spirit, you will comfort. And if there's anyone who is in need, you are Jehovah Jireh, God our provider. You will provide. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. And right now, we will want to pray for our nation together. I encourage you to pray aloud. But before we pray together, let me read to you the scripture that we are going to proclaim even over our nation. May your unfailing love be with us, Lord, even as we put our hope in you. Psalms 33, verse 22. Let's pray aloud. O God, our Heavenly Father, we lift up Malaysia before you in our prayer, even as a state of emergency has been declared and targeted lockdowns have been implemented in response to the spiraling COVID-19 pandemic. grant wisdom and insight to those formulating and enforcing laws and regulations to be applied on all sectors, as well as on all public movement and activities. May the political, economic, and social fallout be kept at a minimal, especially for vulnerable and marginalized groups. Let all segments of society play their part by adhering to all safety SOPs. May we as a nation take heed of lessons learned from mistakes that have led to the current state of the pandemic. Guide and protect the many men and women serving as the nation's frontliners in the ongoing fight against the pandemic. May the infectivity rate be reduced and the pandemic curve be flattened, especially in the red zones and in the rural areas. O God, have mercy upon this nation and preserve her in these difficult times. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And right now we want to continue our worship by giving of our tithes and offering. God assured us that give and it shall be given unto you. Pressed down, shaken together, running over, shall it be returned to us. Because He is Jehovah Jireh, the Lord who provides for us. Now, there are two ways that you can do in giving of your tithes and offering. You can bank in online through the online Maybank, or you can click on the e-wallet and then you can give your offering there. Thank you for your giving. And surely, I pray the Lord will bless you. Lord, we pray that you will use what we have given to you, Lord, for your glory, for your honor. We take it that, Lord, in this very challenging time, although for some of us it's difficult to give, but we give cheerfully. And we shall see your promise that you will provide for all our needs according to your riches in glory. Amen. And today, if you have not joined us last week, you will not know that we have started a new series. But if you have, praise the Lord, you will know that we have kicked off our new series entitled Kingdom DNA. We are exploring the principles we are called to live by as disciples through one of Jesus' most famous sermons. That is the Sermon on the Mount. And with that, we'd like to welcome Pastor Josephine Liu, who is going to share with us the kingdom principles of being a disciple for the word today.
A blessed morning, brothers and sisters in Christ. I would like to entitle my message this morning as Kingdom Principles for Kingdom Living. Last week, Elder Saul started the series of Kingdom DNA by sharing on the keys to the Kingdom of God, what are the principles we can apply and practice, and how we can enter into this kingdom with values and principles taught through the Sermon on the Mount. He also shared about the eternal kingdom and the kingdom of God that is within us, that is within every believer, that distinguishes us from the world. Today, I continue sharing from the Beatitudes from Matthew 5, 7 to 12. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers,
for they will be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way, they persecuted the prophets who were before you. You see, the Sermon on the Mount was spoken to his disciples. Jesus wanted them to know about scriptures, not just in the head, but to live them out as life principles. We see Jesus mention this at the end of the sermon. This is called one of the longest sermons, right? From Matthew 5 to Matthew 7. At the end of the 7, in Matthew 7, verse 24 to 26, it says, "Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rains came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house. Yet it did not fall, because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell with a great crash." You see, these life principles have to be put in practice. And it is the very foundation that is built in us that causes us to be standing strong in times of shakings, through the storms of life, challenges and difficulties that we are facing and will face in the future. This foundation that we build by practicing and living these principles will cause us to remain steadfast in the faith, so that ultimately we can inherit the blessings that has been prepared for us. You know, Jesus was trying to emphasize how important these teachings were by going up to the mountainside where he sat down and his disciples came to him. All right, there was multitudes of people around, but he chose to go up to the mountainside and he spoke to his disciples. It showed the seriousness of what he was about to share. You see, when Jesus was speaking to them, he was communicating who he was through the Sermon on the Mount. He was letting them know who he was through his teachings. He was imparting his very life, which was shown in the way he lived, and he expected his disciples to emulate. So when we disciple someone, we are actually imparting life to them, not just mere words. Our lives speak louder than words. You know, Elder Saul also shared that the Sermon on the Mount was a clear direction on how we should live as his children, not legalistic observation of the law, but the spirit of the law, what is in the heart of God. These kingdom principles are lived out as we choose to repent from the religious systems or worldly systems that have influenced our lives. You know, when Jesus came, he first preached about repentance, right? To bring them back to what is right. Not a worldly system, not a religious system, but kingdom principles that we should follow. So I want to continue with the Beatitudes from Matthew 5, verse 7. "Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy." You know, whenever Jesus showed his attributes, there was always the opposite attributes shown by the Pharisees. You know, there was totally opposite of who he was. For example, he demonstrated mercy in the way he acted with the woman caught in adultery. The Pharisees said, "Those caught in adultery must be stoned according to the law of Moses." But Jesus told her to live a life of sin, for he does not condemn her. He showed that he truly had come to save the sinners, the tax collectors, the prostitutes, people deserving of condemnation. But Jesus came to seek out these ones. His mercy and love draws people into his kingdom, where people would disregard them, look down on them. But his heart, the heart of Jesus, was to reach out to these very ones.
Jesus said in Matthew 9:12, "It is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. But go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice, for I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners." How do we react towards those who are underprivileged, who are, you know, prisoners, prostitutes? Do we despise them in our hearts? And do we say that they are beyond redemption? Have we spent time actually praying for them? They are in the midst of this thick darkness, you know. How much time have we spent actually upholding them? Because Jesus came for them. He showed how much He loved them. And, you know, Jesus showed His mercy also when He was leaving Jericho. There was two blind men sitting, and they were, when they heard Jesus passing through, they called out to Him, "Lord, Son of David, have mercy on us." And the people told them to be quiet, rebuked them and told them to be quiet, probably finding them a bother. But Jesus, in the midst of the crowds, the busyness, He heard them. He stopped and He asked them, "What can I do for you?" And Jesus, He showed His compassion on them and He healed them. They wanted their sight. They were blind. Immediately, they received their sight and followed Him. Immediately, they received their sight. And what did they do next? They followed Him. Wow. Don't underestimate the power of one encounter with the living God. People are in need of love and mercy of God. When they experience this mercy through us, just one encounter can cause them to really desire Him, to follow Him. You know, miracles and healings are often linked to a heart of mercy and compassion. Are we too busy to hear the cries of the needy, the destitute, and the outcasts of society? See, in the midst of the crowd, Jesus heard them. He healed them. And, you know, it shows really His heart of love and compassion. So in what circumstances can we be merciful to others that will ultimately portray Christ-likeness in us? When we have been wronged, you know, and sinned against, are we able to forgive easily? Or do we feel that we have a right to hold that offense and bear grudges and unforgiveness in our hearts? Mercy matters because we all need forgiveness. We are not perfect. You know, we sin against others and others sin against us, and there's always a need to forgive. Christ's mercy is His total favor, given gladly to the undeserving heart. He will never keep a record of our sins or failings. You know, in Lamentations 3:22-23, it says, "It is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, because His compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is Thy faithfulness." You know, we can really depend on God's mercy and His forgiveness through all our shortcomings. You know, God is still doing a refining work in us. And this attribute of mercy as we give to others, you know, depicts His heart, that we are willing to humble ourselves and say we forgive in spite of what has been done against us. And this will actually touch the hearts of the people. This will liberate them to know that they are forgiven. So His mercy can never be properly explained. It is experienced. The only way we can explain mercy is by being merciful ourselves. Remember the story of the unmerciful servant? He had his own huge debt wiped away, but he refused to forgive another servant who owed him a few cents comparatively. So whenever we find it hard to forgive, remember how much we have been forgiven. and release our hearts to forgive those who have hurt us, who have wronged us. Mercy. This, we need to show forth God's mercy. So we come to the next one, which says, blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. In Jeremiah 17, 9-10, it says, the heart is deceitful above all things and beyond cure. Who can understand it? I, the Lord, search the heart and examine the mind to reward a man according to his conduct, according to what his deeds deserve. You know, sin separates us from a close and intimate relationship with God. David's cry in Psalm 51 was, create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. David was one who knew the presence of God. He always longed to be in his presence. But when he sinned against God in committing adultery with Bathsheba, he wanted to come back to that place of abiding. He said, do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. So he came back to the presence of God by confessing his sins. So whenever we have sins and not confessed before God, it becomes a place that blocks us from the fullness of his presence. The joy and gladness seems to be stolen away from us. We suffer guilt, shame, heaviness. But we thank God that through Jesus Christ, we are able to confess our sins and come back to a close relationship with Father God. You know, the prime target of the enemy is to cause our hearts to be defiled, to cause us to hold bitterness, anger, resentments, and to cause us to lust after the things of the world. And he defiles our heart. Instead of being pure, it is defiled. And this area of defilement hinders us from coming and enjoying the very presence of God. So this seeing God, you know, the pure in heart shall see God, is not just in future where we enter the eternal kingdom, but it is present. When we have these things inside of us, we can't see God even in Scripture. It does not speak to us anymore. We have doubts, we have unbelief. It hinders us from seeing God even in the Word. It hinders us from seeing God in the everyday life, where God is showing us, you know, His protection, His provision, His care. We don't see it. We are blinded because of the condition of our hearts. So sin separates us from God, and that's why we need to purify our hearts. And through the cross of Calvary, we have direct access to the very presence of our Lord. And the more we have of Him in us, the more of His presence is over us. You know, and the more of the Word of God that we read, it cleanses us from within, purifies us. Don't we need to be cleansed? Don't we need to be purified in our hearts? You know, God puts us through tests, sometimes through stresses, through pressures, to see what is really deep inside of us. And when these things surface, it is time for us to actually tell the Lord, honestly repent before Him and confess it before God. That, you know, we still have anger, impatience, and, you know, things that come up when we are under pressure. We want God to really cause us to have self-control in our lives, to purify that which defiles our heart. So, having a pure heart is truly a divine work of the Holy Spirit. So we need the outpouring of His presence, the outpouring of His Holy Spirit in us to bring restoration to our heart, to bring wholeness and healing, and to make it pure once again. You know, discipling others is really imparting life of Christ to others. It is out of the purity of our hearts that we will rightly portray who Christ is. And it says in Psalm 51, 17, the sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. God will not despise us when we come before Him with a contrite heart to tell Him of our sins, our brokenness, our mistakes, you know. And God really wants to restore us. He really wants to do that work of building us up, that we are able to be strengthened to face challenges, to be able to impart life to others. That we are not instead proud, or, you know, we don't really look inside of us. And these things are still there. These things are not dealt with. And these things could actually cause us to fall one day. So blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. I believe all of us long to have the very presence of God in our lives. In fact, this is the very thing that will hold us in these tumultuous times, these difficult times. It is the presence of God that will strengthen us. And we want to be so closely intimate with God. He is the one that will hold us in our places of difficulties, our challenges, our stresses of life. You know, we go through different seasons. You may be in a season where you feel all alone. You feel that you're in such a deep need and you can't really reach out to, you know, to people to ask for help even. You know, the Lord sees and He knows. As you come before Him in this place of brokenness, you know, the Lord just reaches out to you. Remember, He never will forsake you. This is a very challenging time for many. People are going through difficulties in their marriages, in their families, with their children. Many people are sick. People have fallen ill. People have COVID-19. There's so much of fear in the hearts of the people. And we need to come back to that place of abiding in God, letting our hearts rest, letting our hearts be filled with peace, and allow our hearts to be strengthened to face a new day again. The last point I want to share is, blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Persecution is part and parcel of Christian living. You know, when Paul was discipling Timothy, it is said in 2 Timothy 3, 10 to 12. You, however, know all about my teaching, my way of life, my purpose, faith, patience, love, endurance, persecutions, sufferings. What kinds of things happened to me in Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra? The persecutions I endured. Yet the Lord rescued me from all of them. In fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ will be persecuted, while evil men and imposters will go from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. See, Paul was imparting his very life to Timothy, and he was telling him what was to come, you know, which included persecutions and sufferings, and how he had to endure it. He warned Timothy that all who live a godly life in Christ will be persecuted. Whenever you make a stand for God, whenever you do not compromise in a situation, whenever the world says to do this and you say no, you will be persecuted. And God promised us there will be eternal blessings of rewards when we stand firm upon His word and let our light shine in the midst of being tempted to compromise. So, are we going through this persecution? If not, ask ourselves why. Maybe we are so much a part of the world system, so much a part of what the world is doing, and not standing for righteousness, not standing to speak up for what is right, that we don't experience persecution at all because we are not actually making a stand for the Lord. We have to question ourselves why we are not persecuted. Because a godly life, if we live a godly life, we will be persecuted. Maybe we are afraid to make stands. Maybe some of us do not even share the gospel in our places of work. They don't even know you are a Christian. So we need to check ourselves. Is there fear of being rejected by the people? Fear of persecution, fear of being, you know, alone. And this silence speaks a lot. In God's eyes, why we are remaining silent? Why are we agreeing with the world and the worldly standards? Why are we not making a stand for Him? So as we come to this place, we also know that those who have known Christ, they have suffered persecution in that they have been rejected by their families. They have been rejected by their communities. Some have even lost their jobs when they actually embrace Christ in their lives. And this is part and parcel of what we as Christians have to go through. So when we disciple someone, it is actually sharing with them that a walk with Christ is one that we need to forgive. Forgive our persecutors. Humble ourselves to go through persecution. And to be able to say like Jesus did, you know, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. I believe that we have not come to the point of being persecuted, to the point of suffering. But let's prepare ourselves to embrace ourselves strong in our hearts, that we will not let go of our faith, that we will continue to remain faithful to the Lord. It's something that we need to really pray even now for ourselves, for our church, to remain faithful to the end. Because persecution will come. Persecution is already here. You know, we are fighting a battle in the heavenlies as well. Satan tempted Jesus to give him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor if he would bow down to worship him. You know, each kingdom have their own principles. Each kingdom have their own code of ethics and standards. Which kingdom do we belong to? That's why when Jesus came, he first taught on repentance. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near. A turning away from the kingdom of the world and entering into His kingdom by being born again. So we want to really thank God that, you know, we are now in the kingdom of light. We have been translated from the kingdom of darkness into His light. But do not forget, Satan will still be there to tempt us to compromise, to tempt us to follow the worldly systems and standards, and lose that effectiveness of being shining for Him. That our testimony is marred because of compromise. That our strength is being weakened because we have given in to lust or sin. So we need to be able to strengthen what is within us through the Word of God, through practicing what the Lord has told us to do. It's not head knowledge. It's a life of living out His principles. Yes, it's not easy. There'll be times it'll be difficult. But when we have a heart where we say, Lord, I choose to be broken by this and I humble myself to seek Your strength to act the way You want me to do, to be what You want me to be, then we come to another level. We have overcome. We will be tested. And finally, you know, Jesus has promised us an eternal kingdom that will never fade away. While on earth, we will be tested, we will be trained in godliness to live out His kingdom principles. And that is for us to one day reign with Christ, rule and reign with Christ. Let us really be thankful for the heart of Jesus, you know, in drawing us away from the crowds, in wanting us to come to that place of quietness where He will begin to search our hearts and He begin to speak to us that He wants these areas changed. Let us draw away. Let us come to the Lord and say, Lord, help me to live out these principles. Help me to not just know it in my head. Help me to humble myself. Help me to lay down my life. And this is our prayer this morning. So I just want you, you know, to just close your eyes. Wherever we are right now, let us humble ourselves before God. We want to embrace the Sermon on the Mount. We want to be able to live out the principles truly by His grace and by the help of the Holy Spirit. So let us pray for one another. Let us pray. Thank you, Lord. Lord Jesus, we want to thank you that you have called us to a life of discipleship. And you want us to enter this kingdom and live out the kingdom principles to demonstrate who you are, to show the people who you are, that we are not like the world. We are not of this world. That we are different. And Lord, we bring our hearts before you. Many times, Lord, we have failed you, Lord. We have compromises in our lives. We have not spoken up and we need to speak up. And when we spoke up, it was just exactly as how the world speaks. We have not really stood up for your principles of what you would say in a particular situation. For all these, God, we ask your forgiveness. For the times our hearts have been defiled by the things of this world, by all the bitterness, the anger, the resentments. Lord, you just cleanse our hearts, Lord. Purify us because we really want to come to that closeness with you, God. Help us, Lord, to be merciful. Help us to be merciful just like you, Lord. Give us this heart of mercy towards others. Especially those who have been rejected, the outcasts of society. Give us a heart to really look out for them, to pray for them, to help them. And right now, Lord, we want to uphold one another too, Lord, in the area of persecution. Those who live a godly life will be persecuted. Forgive us if we have never made a stand for you, where you have put us, whether in our neighborhood, our community, whether in our workplaces, we have not actually spoken about you or what you would say in a situation. We have been silent. Or we have been following what the world has said. Lord, you forgive us. Forgive us for even this lack of persecution that we should be actually going through, you know. Lord, you forgive us. And we want to pray, Lord, for the many people who are persecuted for their faith, rejected by their families, rejected by communities, that, Lord, you will cause them to remain faithful and strong. You will envelop them with your grace and strength, Lord. Father, we want to stand with them. We want to say, Lord, may your mercy, your love be poured mightily over them. We continue to cry out to you to speak to us through the Sermon of the Mount as weeks would come by, that we will continue to hunger for your truths and to live them out. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Thank you and God bless.
Thank you, Pastor Joe, for sharing with us Kingdom Principles. From Matthew chapter 5, verse 7 to 12. Kingdom principles must not only be heard, but it must be lived out. And the kingdom principles that Pastor Joe shared with us just now is the principle of showing mercy. Truly, in this very challenging time, people are going through different emotions, and we, the people of light, we, the people of the kingdom of God, must continue to show mercy to those around us, within our family, within our workplace, within our neighborhood. And Pastor Joe also reminded us about the principle of being pure in heart, that we must not allow sin to be in our hearts, in our lives, because sin separates us from God. That indeed, in this very challenging time, if we want to see God, let's continue through the power of the Holy Spirit, stay pure in hearts, in mind. And the last point that Pastor Joe shared with us is about persecution. Even to be persecuted is blessed. And if we have never experienced persecution before, maybe we have not been living out the kingdom principles. But even if we are persecuted, God is with us. We are overcomers. We shall be the light. We shall be the people that the world will see that we are living in the kingdom of light. So right now, let's make the decision today to live out these kingdom principles every day in our life, throughout this week, throughout the month, throughout 2021, till we see Jesus. Let us even right now say, God, because I live these principles, that I will also be able to encourage someone else to live in according to the kingdom principles of God. Today, if you feel that you are going through such challenges that you are very overwhelmed, before we do the closing prayer, perhaps you have not received Jesus yet. The good news is this, that there are pastors who will be able to lead you in prayer to accept Jesus as your Lord, God, and Savior. That you need not journey these challenging and difficult times alone. Click on the raise hand button. The pastors will be there to respond to you and lead you in prayer. And if you do need someone to pray together with you, you can click on the raise hand button. The pastors and our elder will also be there to pray together with you. I want to encourage for those who have clicked on and the raise hand prayer, and I have personally prayed for someone and they have responded to me and said, Pastor, thank you for praying because God has answered our prayer. Right now, let's pray together. Father, help us to lift out the kingdom principles that we have just learned today, to be merciful, to be pure in heart, and when we face persecution, not to despair, but instead, we must remember that through you, we are more than overcomers. So help us, O God, as we live these kingdom principles in our daily life, that we will be the light shining in the midst of darkness. Please watch over us, protect us and our family, and be with us. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And right now, to Him who is more than able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think according to the power at work within us, to Him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. God bless you. See you again.
咁我25岁到35岁都系冇做工嘅，啊，成日困埋嗰啲所谓嘅兄弟。就受影響咯，每日都飲酒， 賭錢同埋吸毒，因為我覺得呢班人所謂兄弟，即係我好兄弟、好朋友，佢哋發到快樂俾我，所以又開始又去揾快錢呢個諗頭啦。咁就喺35歲嗰年，因為錢用曬啦，咁咪去走私毒品，係中國大陸走翻嚟馬來西亞。我喺廣州白雲機場捉到啦，判咗我無期徒刑，人生玩完咯。咁頭3年咧，的確好難過嘅喺監獄入邊，因為過年過節啦，你媽生日啦，你都唔喺你嘅身邊。咁你一心諗住想出監，我想見我屋企人啊，所以做好自己啊，得到減刑咯。我坐大約15年，咁我係2016年1月翻嚟馬來西亞嘅，翻嚟咧諗住開心啦，因為得到自由啊嘛。但係相反，人生好似冇目標，冇咗方向，人生價值觀我都唔記得咗啦。因為同邊個講呢？一個人屋企，但係有3句説話，每一日都喺我頭腦度轉嚟轉去嘅：仇恨、報仇、憤怒。都係冇覺好瞓嘅6個月。咁有一日，我喺布吉便當就見我堂妹，我同我堂妹講我個當時嘅情況係點樣樣。過後佢又叫我去呢個 Alpha Course， 我聽到 Alpha 課程咧，有啲反應好大咯，因為上課嘛。我幾十歲人啊，要我攞住咩攞住個書包就嚟上課咩？跟住我就問佢咯：呢個 Alpha 課程係咩嚟嘅？佢淨係話飲嘅、食嘅、玩嘅，全部都是免費。咁聽到飲食免費，梗係反應好大啦。咁我咪去參加呢個 Alpha 課程。我去參加 Alpha 咧，前2個禮拜到1個月咧，都係一個人企喺角落頭嗰度，因為我啱啱放監出嚟嘅人啊，自卑感好強，同埋唔相信人嘅。佢哋好多次都叫我去同佢哋傾偈啊，我會過去傾偈，傾一句，我又翻翻去我自己嗰個角落頭嗰度坐。第一樣嘢係令我好打動到我心嘅，就係嗰啲教會嘅人啊，對我好好。佢哋唔單止冇睇唔起我，仲接受我一個平常嘅人，唔係一個坐過監嘅人。跟住喺 video 入邊咧，有幾個嗰啲見證同我差唔多一樣，所以我心喺度諗咯。如果呢個神係真嘅，可以改變呢個人嘅人生，呢、這個神都應該係可以改變我人生。我個 Alpha Weekend Away 咧，一個禮拜朝頭早咧係祈禱嘅。我哋教會嘅長老 Richie 咁就嚟同我講 ：Jonathan 有好消息話俾你知，因為耶穌已經原諒咗你。嗰一刻我真係想喊出嚟嘅，但係當時有好多人啊嘛，邊度好意思喊呢？男子漢嘛，流血不流淚嘛。但係咧，將我哋心交咗俾耶穌之後咧，呢樣係擋唔到嘅。咁我就喊到好犀利，喊到咧眼淚又嚟，鼻涕都嚟埋啦。咁當時感覺就係好似有兩嚿大石，呢幾十年啊壓住我身上啊，而家又掉下碎曬，同埋嗰啲所謂嘅鎖鏈鎖住我幾十年啊，都係俾耶穌嘅愛同嘅力量幫我全部掹斷曬嘅。當時覺得可以自己好輕咗，因為係真係自由咗，可以識飛啊！我翻 retreat 翻嚟咧，我睇唔到我自己嘅改變嘅，係教會嘅人見到嘅改變。做一個唔識笑嘅人，冇喜樂嘅人，變咗有笑容有喜樂。我開始同佢哋傾偈咯，同佢哋交流咯。佢哋見到我成個人係360度轉變。進咗住之後，好大嘅改變啦。第一，我嘅人生目標，我有咗方向，我有咗呢、這個記得翻呢個咩就叫做人生價值觀。之前是沒有希望嘛，從一個沒有希望的人變成有個希望的人，同埋我本來是一個很充滿仇恨的人，而家冇咗。其實有很多人，很多坐過監的人，好像我咁樣啊，好多坐監的人咧，唔論你犯咩罪都好，出到嚟是需要我哋去幫助。我而家得到神的光同埋神的愛，我想將佢份愛嚟傳出俾其他人。鼓勵多啲人出嚟大膽啲面對呢個社會，因為可以靠耶穌，靠我自己係做唔到，但係靠耶穌係可以做得到。